Next up, we have Marko, and he's talking about some Kubernetes scaling. So I'm curious to hear what he has to tell us. Enjoy.
Thank you. Yeah, that was quite an introduction. Something about Kubernetes. I'm sure everybody loves Kubernetes, right? Yay! So, as said, we're going to be talking a little bit about Kubernetes and scaling, specifically autoscaling. Just a fair heads up to everyone. It's going to involve some YAML, and it's going to involve some terminal as well. So I hope everybody likes the demo.
Cool.
Let's get it started then. So I'm going to start with a story. So that actually happened maybe a couple of months ago. And funny enough, we just had a conversation about public transport. And I was actually traveling from Manchester to Scotland. And this big storm was coming out from the Atlantic. And they had to cancel like probably most of the trains up to Scotland. So I was kind of inquiring on the train station, just asking like, are you sure I can get to Scotland tonight? Because I would rather be stuck here than kind of somewhere in the middle. I said, yeah, that's fine. You just take the first train in the similar direction. There will be coaches that will be taking you up north. It's all good. And I said, okay, fine. I board this train. I get like halfway through. There were no trains, no coaches. I got stuck, right? And I said, oh shit, what am I gonna do? So accidentally, there's another train kind of coming through, and it takes me up to Glasgow. We arrive there, like, as you can imagine, it arrives there, middle of the night, empty train station, nobody was there, there were no coaches, no buses, anything that would take me to my final destination. And, you know, it was an interesting challenge, like, from the resourcing perspective, like, you know, they didn't have the resource to take me to my destination, what are they gonna do? And I wouldn't usually talk positively about British railways, but in this case, they actually pulled it through. So there is actually legislation in place where they either have to find you an accommodation or they need to take you to your final destination either way. So that what they actually did is quite fascinating. They actually called taxi for all of us on the platform and they kind of drove us home. So it was a really good example of, you know, how you can manage your resources, you know, kind of replacing the ones that you don't have with something else. And this is literally what I would like you to kind of take away from this talk today is how to efficiently manage resources and how to kind of right size them. I think that's the kind of really the key point here. So a little bit about me. I'm head of consultancy at the Scale Factory. We are a B2B SaaS consultancy that kind of specifically specializes in AWS consultancy. We're also advanced consulting partner and a Kubernetes service provider. My main background is mainly ops. So I used to spend quite a lot of years kind of dealing with infrastructure problems all the way from data centers and now kind of ended up mostly in cloud space. Through my kind of history, I wore different hats, but regardless what job I did, I was always somehow involved with the open source community and always kind of ingrained in it, especially from the perspective of I'm an active contributor and maintainer of a couple of open source projects. You could probably find me in maintaining the Argo hand chart. I've contributed something to Karpenter as well, because I definitely think it's a project worth contributing to. I quite like the approach you're taking. And in my spare time, what I like to do is kind of automation, simplifying things, hiking and traveling, which obviously has become an option again after the 2 years of being locked in. So well done. And on that point, really good to see all of you here, because I think not having this conference for a couple of years, that was definitely a kind of a big call that I don't think the online stuff would fail, right? Right, so let's get started with the fun stuff. So Kubernetes, right? So who would think that the most popular orchestrator, I mean, obviously that's kind of a, depends which side of the story you are, doesn't have a built-in autoscaling, right? Because out of the box, if you install Kubernetes either on-prem or you kind of spin up in any of the major cloud providers, you wouldn't have the autoscaling kind of built-in, which kind of feels like a big drawback, right? Like, you know, you have this amazing system that can do things, but it cannot autoscale, and you need to ensure that from your end. So if you kind of drill it down a bit, kind of really quick recap, in Kubernetes, you either have pods or you have nodes. Before we dive into it, like, how many of you are using Kubernetes, like, on a daily basis? Okay. About a third, half of the room? Okay, good. So let's maybe like I said, start from the resources. So you kind of have two basic resources. So obviously, like I said, you have either pods, which can be used to kind of host or kind of where you would run your workloads, literally, how you package them up. And then you would have nodes, which are literally just the capacity which you use in terms of like instances or the compute kind of units that you would kind of run the pods on, right? And there are other resources, but because we're kind of focusing mostly on kind of autoscaling, we're going to be mostly looking at those today. So let's quickly run through the kind of the horizontal scaling, how that's done actually, and let's start with the pod level, right? So the you would have horizontal pod autoscaler, which kind of observes the metrics in terms of CPU and memory usage, and based on that, whatever your target utilization is, it would just kind of usually scale out and would just add additional pods to kind of scale out horizontally, so you would end up with more capacity in terms of how you run your application. And there's a caveat, it doesn't apply really to non-scalable objects such as VM sets, for example. The second concept kind of parallel to that would be vertical scaling, right? You can say if you can horizontally scale, you can obviously vertically scale as well. And compared to horizontal scaler, vertical scaler is instead of adding more units, you would literally kind of extend your unit. So for example, if you're speaking, you know, in terms of pods, you would replace your pod with a larger pod. And when I say larger pod, that means the number of resources that you allocate to it. And the main thing about this one is it's mainly to adjust the size and power for the resource and kind of resources and limits on the pod that you have. So we kind of covered the horizontal scaling and the vertical scaling. You could actually do multi-dimensional scaling as well. Google has a solution for that. There is a scaler that knows how to scale horizontally and vertically at the same time. And then you have different kind of auto-scaling solutions as well, such as Kada, which is an event-driven auto-scaler, which kind of basically just scales up based on the events that happen in the cluster, right? And obviously there are other solutions such as K-native, but let's skip those for now because it's not kind of main focus. So let's quickly have a look at the cluster autoscaler. How many of you are familiar with cluster autoscaler? Okay. Again, the same amount of people that are using Kubernetes. I'm slightly confused because it's different people, so slightly confusing, but okay, fine. You might actually call it a de facto standard for the scaling. What it is, it's literally a controller, as you can see on this very graphical diagram that I didn't create it. I just kind of copied it off from AWS. I think there is a copyright somewhere there on the photo, you cannot see it. So how does it actually work is quite simple. You run a controller in your cluster, it observes your kind of requirements, and in case you run out of capacity where you can kind of schedule your pods on, it will just say, oh fine, let's use underlying cloud concepts or kind of building blocks such as auto-scaling groups, and say fine, we are out of resources, let's just scale it up on the cloud level, that would add more instances to our cluster, and this would kind of unlock us in terms of we can schedule those pods and run it on our Kubernetes cluster, right? Sounds kind of simple enough, right? And you know, like I said, in terms of being a de facto standard, it's kind of battle tested as well. It kind of runs really well up to 1,000 nodes and 30 pods per node. So, you know, it kind of is tested across different cloud providers as well. So you can use it on everything from GCP, AWS, Azure, you name it. There are a couple of like really exotic ones supported as well. And like I said, it's using underlying building blocks from cloud providers to kind of do that thing, so it doesn't do anything on its own. It only knows how to kind of scale up and scale out based on those. And it comes with a couple of kind of challenges by using it. For example, because it's using those underlying building blocks, because obviously we are AWS technologies, I'm going to use AWS kind of terminology, but feel free to kind of use anything in those terms that relates to the cloud provider that you're using. So because it's using those, it comes with limitations that those building blocks come with. So for example, in node groups, which kind of map directly to the auto-scaling groups, they can only provision the same amount of capacity. So for example, if you have auto-scaler, it only knows how to provision the same instances all over again. So it can, obviously, it can horizontally scale, but it won't change the capacity because that's kind of limitation. Then the official recommendation is to use an auto-scaling group or an node group per AZ. The reason for that is because if you span it across the AZs, you can do that, but there are specific resources that you might be using from the pods, such as EVS volumes or any kind of persistent storage, and that will be actually bound per AZ, and you could end up with a weird situation where you would see the additional capacity coming in, but you wouldn't be still able to schedule your pods because the underlying dependencies, such as volumes, would be accessible. It's also quite complex to use. I know that's kind of a relative thing, but since we're talking about Kubernetes, this is kind of the name of the game anyway. So if you're into the ecosystem, that's kind of almost accepted. But I would definitely say, let's not make it more complex than it needs to be, or let's not add complexity to it, right? And it's kind of tightly bound to the to the Kubernetes scheduler as well. So if you bump your Kubernetes version, you have to follow with the version of the autoscaler as well. So you have to kind of upgrade it in one go. How does it work? Like I said, it's very simple. It has basic four concepts there. So it has a reconciliation and filtering. So it kind of checks all your pods, how many of them are kind of unscheduled, kind of tries to simulate the capacity that would satisfy that, and just adds additional instances to it. So like I said, it does the scaling up. So it does the in-memory simulation of the capacity that would be needed to satisfy that. By default, it does it in loops of 10 seconds, yes. And in case you're using different auto-scaling groups, you can define things such as expanders, which are literally just a different ways to kind of define strategies how you can scale up your nodes across different node groups. So let's maybe not spend too much time on it, because that's not our focus, right? So because we kind of know what all cluster autoscaler is, which is de facto standard, let's look how the scheduling of our workloads work, actually. So I'm not a graphic designer, so those are really simplified versions of what's actually happening, but I think it should illustrate what's actually happening in the background. So let's say you're running your Kubernetes somewhere in the cloud for the sake of the argument, because obviously you don't want to deal with all the nitty-gritty bits, and you have a control plane that kind of manages everything and exposes the API and kind of ensures the scheduling is happening. So in this case, we have a single node and a single pod that's scheduling that node, and let's say, you scale it up, or let's say you spin up an additional workload that runs a different pod and it needs to be scheduled. What would happen in this case is it would just be kind of scheduled on the available capacity on the node that we're currently running. Everything fine, right? You could say, everything's fine, all dandy. Going forward, let's say, okay, let's add another pod, throw it in, say, okay, let's schedule that. So the scheduler will go and say, like, oh, additional pod, fine. Let's try to schedule it, and we say, oh, we don't have the capacity anymore on that node, so that pod actually ends up being unscheduled, and it kind of waits and sits there until the capacity becomes available, because that's kind of not the problem with the scheduler, right? So in case we're using cluster autoscaler, what would happen in this case is pod is still there, sitting, waiting to be scheduled, cluster autoscaler detects, oh, okay, we need to schedule it somewhere, let's add some capacity in, so it throws another node in, right? And funnily enough, that pod gets scheduled there, no problem there. And then let's say we add another pod, and that pod is slightly bigger than the capacity of our current nodes that we're running, right? So what would happen in this case? Pod would end up unscheduled, plus the autoscaler would unable to be set, would be unable to satisfy that resource request, and it would just sit there waiting until you either add additional node group that has the capacity that can support that, or it just wouldn't be scheduled. And this is the fun part, where actually the Karpenter comes in as an alternative solution, which kind of brings slightly more kind of dynamic auto-scaling in terms of adding different kinds of capacity based on the needs and based on the workloads that you actually want to run. So obviously that ended up unscheduled, and if we look how that looks like with Karpenter, is Karpenter will go and say, like, okay, I have a huge pod now. Obviously, I cannot schedule that on a node that you know, we spun up before. So let's add a larger node, bigger node, that could actually fit that pod and successfully schedule it in. And on top of it, what you can actually do is you can actually specify a pool of nodes which it can choose from. So you actually can filter the nodes, for example, by CPU type, architecture, GPU, and other kind of parameters that you can get from it. So we kind of look how Karpenter is kind of solving that problem and what it is. So let's kind of step back a bit and look what Karpenter is and kind of a little bit kind of zoom out and look, let's have a look from the kind of 10-foot perspective what actually is. So you can describe Karpenter as a Kubernetes node lifecycle solution. So it's an open source incubated project from AWS, but it has been designed as a vendor neutral, so it does support adding additional providers. Unfortunately, only AWS is currently supported, but I think there are conversations going up where the project has been kind of obviously published as a repository on AWS Git organization. But there are conversations of kind of adopting that slightly more into the CNCF space and kind of start to get traction for other providers to kind of chip in and kind of ride their own. How it actually works on that level? It observes the aggregate resource requests of unscheduled pods. So in this kind of terms, it's quite similar to cluster autoscaler. But with the difference that it actually knows how to pick the right underlying node that could actually run your workloads on. And you know, on top of that, it knows how to provision that capacity just in time, so it doesn't have to pre-provision anything. It just spins it up when it's needed. And it's actually smart enough and or intelligent enough, it's trying to be, where it actually knows how to simulate the different kind of workloads and kind of deprovision the nodes that are over-provisioned and kind of tries to balance it out, all to kind of try to be cost efficient as well, which I believe we all will try to be in 2023, where the industry is going, I guess. And the kind of the target and the outcome is trying to optimize for the capacity and price at all kind of times. Right, so let's quickly have a look at the key concepts. So the rollout and setup is fairly straightforward. When I say straightforward, as straightforward as it can be in Kubernetes, I guess. So what you have to do in order to get it rolled out is literally four steps. So the first one would be provision the IAM roles of service accounts. So this literally ensures that the Karpenter controller that you're gonna install has enough permission to kind of spin additional nodes and add them to the cluster. Then obviously install the controllers, there is a helm chart, and everybody loves a good helm chart, right? Then you have to kind of apply the provisioner CRD. So there is a additional component to it. So you have a controller, which kind of runs in this loop, checking for the capacity. And you would have a CRD as a configuration, which is a cloud-native type of configuration, where you can define all the specific bits of what kind of capacity you want, which kind of instances you want to pick from, what architecture there are, things like that. And the controller would then run the capacity lifecycle loop all the time and constantly watch, evaluate, and provision additional nodes as they are needed. And it will also remove the ones that are either over-provisioned or it will try to defragment your current workload, move the pods to nodes that are underutilized, and remove the nodes that become empty at some point. While it's doing that, it also knows how to kind of look for the well-known labels. So the provisioner kind of is aware of well-known labels, which are so-called. Some of them are defined in Kubernetes space, some of them are specific to Karpenter. So for example, you can limit the architecture which you're picking nodes from. You can limit the OS, you can limit the instance types. It doesn't have to be like here, for example, like a specific one. You can define a list. You can actually define a class of instances. So it's quite flexible what you can do. You can define the zone where you want your node to be provisioned. So you can favor a specific zone, you can eliminate specific zones. It's quite flexible. And then obviously you can kind of pick from different capacity types. So you can either pick from the on-demand or spot instances, which is an additional way of kind of, you know, optimizing for cost, I guess. And what's the most important thing about it? It's multi-dimensional scaling. So as you probably noticed me going through that, is it doesn't only know how to scale up and down, it also knows how to scale in and out. So in addition of adding resources, it knows how to add different sizes of it and kind of also scale in if they're needed, not needed anymore. Let's quickly have a look at the scaling up, how that looks like. So it's basically just provisioning and scaling additional resources. It's just adding just-in-time capacity to meet the demand, and it can be adding the same amount of capacity or larger or smaller capacity based on the need that you currently have. How it achieves better performance than, for example, the de facto industry standard is it's actually not relying on the scheduler, but instead of kind of relying that scheduler is going to do the job eventually, it does the really quick binding of your pods to the nodes that it's provisioning. So because it's actually know what node instances are actually being added, so as those instances are being bootstrapped, it already bins the pods on those instances. So when an instance comes up, it's immediately scheduled for that pod, and scheduler doesn't actually have to do the kind of heavy lifting of figuring out, oh, where I'm going to schedule that now. So it's quite performant as well. And you would end up with additional capacity in kind of in the range of maybe 30, 40 seconds, which I think is quite quick compared to, for example, if you look at a cluster autoscaler, by default, it scales up every 10 seconds, but in order to get a capacity available, it usually takes between maybe 2 minutes, 2 minutes and a half maybe on average, at least on AWS. And the scale down is even slower, like the scale down loop in cluster autoscaler is 10 minutes by default. Like I said before, it has removed decoupling the scheduler, so it's not compiled in with the scheduler dependencies, so you don't have to upgrade it every time you upgrade your clusters, which is kind of a plus as well. I guess we all know how sensitive clusters are where you kind of upgrade it because the whole API can change. Maybe not the whole, but definitely the one that you're using, right? That's usually the case that when you upgrade. So that was scaling up. It also knows how to scale in. So like I said, it knows how to terminate the obsolete capacity, which leads to reducing cost and kind of reducing the overall spend you're having. The interesting feature here, which I would like to kind of draw your attention to, is actually the node DTLs. So it has two parameters you can use in the CRD, which are the expiry DTL and the emptiness DTL. So the emptiness DTL would mean how long would it wait when the node becomes empty before it removes it. And by kind of adjusting that, you can actually kind of define the velocity of how quickly you're reacting to changes. Because obviously some of the workloads might be more dynamic than others, so it's kind of a good approach to kind of maybe not make it too short, I guess. And then the expiration one is quite interesting from the compliance perspective. So what you can actually set here is the DTL on the node, which would, for example, if you set it, let's say, for a month, and after that DTL kind of expires, it would actually go automatically and reprovision those nodes again. And if you can think of compliance story here, is you can actually keep all the nodes kind of fresh and updated and recycled every X amount of time, which I think is quite a cool feature as well. Like I mentioned before, it knows how to consolidate resources, but another thing is it knows how to react to interruptions. So for example, if you're running spot instances, it actually knows how to react to different interruption warnings, health warnings, or termination warnings coming from the cloud provider. So for example, even for the on-demand instances, they might occasionally get shut down because the cloud provider underlying infrastructure is going under specific maintenance, and you get warnings ahead of time, and it actually knows how to listen to those, and it knows to react in terms of provisioning new node and decommissioning this one because it's going to be probably put in maintenance at some point. Right. Just something else that I wanted to mention at this point is how does it actually provision the capacity, or how does it actually do the scheduling? It's using a so-called bin packing algorithm. Who knows what bin packing is? Okay. Yeah. Some people maybe? Okay. So it's kind of a well-known algorithm in where you have an affinity amount of kind of things you want to kind of put in containers that have a predefined size. And what it's actually doing is using the, it's doing it actually in a way that minimizes the number of those bins where you have to put your containers in. And it's actually an NP problem, so it's kind of predictable and it's fairly efficient. And the version of the algorithm it uses is actually first fit descending, which means that it will start with the biggest capacity and kind of makes its way down and try to kind of find the ones that couldn't be fitted efficiently on the big ones and kind of finish with small ones. And it actually knows how to do online bin packing, which is this, and offline bin packing. And offline would be kind of a different name for defragmentation, right? So if you know nodes end up like defragmented, it knows how to consolidate that as well. So let's quickly have a look at the consolidation piece very quickly. So it's literally about rebalancing node workloads. So it kind of observes utilization of the CPU and memory. And it uses two basic mechanisms to achieve that. So the first mechanism is deletion. So it knows how to delete the nodes that are kind of become empty or underutilized. And it actually knows how to replace nodes as well, which is an addition to it. And in terms of replacing, it actually knows how to simulate the optimal spread of the current pod that you're running, and it provisions the capacity that would satisfy that and decommissions the one that are suboptimal or maybe too expensive for the current workload pressure that you're running. Right. Important thing to remember, it's always optimizing for costs. How does it do that? It's kind of observing, querying the API and kind of observing the pricing from the cloud provider and always picking the optimal instances based on the cost and the kind of the size. And at the same time, it's minimizing for the disruption. So it's not just kind of focusing on the cost. That's the first kind of argument. But the second one is also trying to minimize the disruption that's going to kind of be a, like as a fallout effect from you kind of adding or removing specific capacity, right? So it knows how to obey the scheduling constraints such as pod disruption budgets, AAC affinity, topology, and spread constraints. It checks for the unhealthy events, like I mentioned. And it's using least disruption when multiple nodes could be consolidated. So you could end up in a situation where you could consolidate multiple nodes at the same time. It has to pick one that's going to be optimizing. And the rules that it's using is it's always picking the nodes running fewer pods. It's prioritizing the nodes that will soon expire. So even if it hasn't expired yet, it will kind of prioritize those. So the expiration is kind of automatically renewed ahead of time. And obviously nodes with lower priority pods, so if it's using priority, it will pick the lower priority ones over the higher ones. So you can actually put the higher priority on like really important workload that you run, which cannot be disrupted. Or if it is, it should be minimized. Right. Other options you can do with it. You can kind of define a custom user data when spinning up instances. So for example, you can spin up bottle rocket instances. Does anybody know what bottle rocket instance is? Okay, a couple of people, a few people, cool. So it's literally optimized instance run the containerized workloads on. It has a minimal footprint and eliminated all the bloatware that you would see in regular OS instances that you run. You can define specific kubelet configurations, so you can define different container runtimes, so you can switch between container D, Docker daemon, if you still have time of that, and other things. You can set taints or start cut taints on the nodes that's provisioning. You can kind of control the pod density, so you can actually control based on the things like network limitations. So as we all know, different instances come with different limitations of how many ENIs you can have on it, which are network interfaces, and that would actually effectively enforce how many pods you can actually spin up. So you can define static pod density or dynamic, and the limit is defined by topology spread and different instance types. Right. So are we ready for demo or more slides? I do have backup slides. Okay, let's go with demo then. I think it's time. I guess feel like everybody's slightly asleep or they're already thinking about beers, right? Almost there. Right, Luna, so let's see what we're gonna do now. Let me try to figure the thing. As soon as I find my cursor, here it is. It's gonna be easier for me to just start mirroring stuff rather than watching there and not able to see you while I speak. So let's have a quick switch here. I believe everybody's confirmed that last row can approximately read that. There will be more text coming, so don't worry. So let's quickly have a look. What we have here. So I did already pre-provision EKS cluster. It's empty EKS cluster in AWS. It's running some Fargate nodes. If you don't know what Fargate is, it's a serverless solution that kind of dynamically assigns compute to you. So it's kind of fully managed instance nodes. And the reason I'm using that is because I want to run, let's have a look what I'm running. I think that's gonna be better to do. Sorry about that. So what I'm running here is literally just core DNS, because we all know that DNS is the root of all evil, so we have to run this. The second thing is I already deployed Karpenter controllers because I wanted to save some time before you could actually see me waiting until this spun up. So this is literally what we're running. There is nothing else there. I'm kind of slightly lying, there is. Let's have a look. So we have a deployment as well. So there is a deployment which is in the default namespace. It's called Inflate. Very interesting name. The reason why it's called Inflate, you're going to see that in a bit. But before we go there, let's have a look. So already deployed IAM roles for the controller and the controller. The next thing, like I said in the slides, we need to do is we need to deploy a CRD, right? So let's have a look how that looks like. Don't mind, this is a script that I'm going to run, and I'm just going to show you how that looks like before I run it, because otherwise you won't be able to kind of see what's happening. It's very quick. So what we're actually adding is, we're adding a CRE, which is a kind of provisioner. It's custom defined resource from Karpenter, so until you deploy a controller, you wouldn't have that in a default namespace. And what we're actually doing, the interesting bit is the requirements section, actually, in the spec, right? And the requirements are, what we're saying is, we want to limit the instance category where we're going to pick our instances from, and we're going to say, because obviously we want to save money, right? What we're going to say is, let's just pick instance classes from the instance classes C, M, and T. So if you don't know it, the C is compute optimized, M is memory optimized, and the T is the burstable type of instances that you can get, fairly cheap, but also inefficient. But let's go with those because there's something I want to kind of demonstrate based on that. We're kind of limiting something else as well. What we can say is we're going to limit the instance CPU, so we're going to say, oh fine, pick from those classes, but only the instances with 32 or less virtual CPUs. So we don't want to end up with really expensive ones, right? Because otherwise I'm going to wrap up our build. There are a couple of comments. So you can obviously define a hypervisor as well. You can define specific in kind of virtual CPUs. I just said less than, so it's quite flexible. And we're gonna say this is also the list of instances. So it's always an intersection between the category and the list. So I'm kind of narrowing it out a little bit more, so it's gonna be more interesting to demo. Another interesting bit, what we're doing here is we're limiting it only to EU West 1A and 1C. So please pay attention later on. I'm gonna kind of give you a heads up. Please have a look when the nodes are provisioned. They're only going to be in 1A and 1C. There's nothing going to be in 1B. And we are allowing ARM and AMD kind of types of resources because we obviously want to support both. And we're only going to start with demand for now because it's going to be slightly easier to demonstrate things. And we can kind of put limitations on the cumulative number of CPUs we want to kind of provision. So in case I would provision more than 1,000 virtual CPUs, Karpenter would stop. So you can kind of limit the upper, you can actually set the upper limit so you don't end up with unexpected bills. So that would be the provisioner, and there is a reference to a node template you can define. I'm not going to go in detail. It's just a couple of things that you need to define in terms of which security groups are going to attach to, which subnets is going to attach nodes to, and things like that that you can figure out automatically without specifying those bits. And you can use variables such as here to kind of automatically figure this out. So it would automatically discover things based on labels. This is literally what it's doing. Any questions at this point? Okay. Either I'm super confusing you or everything's clear. I'm gonna go with the latter. So let's apply that now. So I'm just gonna run that. It just applied. So we have a provisioner defined, and I'm just gonna quickly show you how the deployment looks like. So I also have a deployment in flight that I showed you earlier. And what we're running is nothing really that interesting here. If you look at the template and spec of the template, what we're literally running is a post container, so not much of a workload. But the reason why I'm using that is it's quite easy to kind of just run it, doesn't do anything, but I can actually set the requests to CPU1, so it's gonna exhaust my CPU limitation on the node, so I can quickly kind of exhaust that and show you how it's scaling. So what we're going to do here, I'm going to run an interesting tool on this side, which is going to monitor the nodes that I'm using, and specifically it's kind of just showing the nodes that Karpenter is provisioning. So it's not showing the, I'm kind of filtering out the nodes that have already been provisioned by Pygate. And what I'm doing here is, what I'm actually saying, I'm just saying like, scale my deployment to one replica. So it's just going to run one thing, and what I'm actually interested in. So I can show you logs here, and let's see what happened here before I kind of show you that. The controller actually figured out, okay, there is one unscheduled pod, and I need to find instance that can run that. So obviously it looked through the instances that I showed you. So this is the list of instances that it kind of found, and it said, okay, I need to fit one pod, and it calculated there is a single instance that can satisfy that, and it just spun up an instance which is literally this one, which is C5 large, X large actually. So slightly over provision, but the reason why it's slightly more than I needed, because I actually provided a list, if you remember. This was actually probably the small one that I specified there. And if you have a look at this, what you can see here, it's just a small tool that just runs in a loop and just checks all the nodes and just prints out specific bits about the nodes, such as CPU utilization, which we're interested in, number of pods that are currently scheduled, type of the instance, how much does it cost, and what type it is, and the status of it, and which zone it runs in. So as you can see, it's EU-S1A, it's on demand, it's currently ready, and it has three pods on it. So you might ask yourself, why three, why not one? I spent up one. Who knows why there's three pods scheduled there?
Every zone?
Sorry?
Every zone?
No. It's not every zone, unfortunately. So when you spin up nodes, it has to spin up the queue proxy pods as well. So those are kind of scheduled on those nodes as well. So please don't mind if the number's not going to match what you request, but we're currently running one pod that you kind of wanted, and the rest of it is there. So we can confirm that we're just checking the pods, and you're going to see we actually have one instance of in-play deployment up and running. So what we can actually do is, let's say we want three now, right? Let's say, fine, we have one, let's go with three. I'm going to show you this, and what happened here is it immediately scheduled those pods, and it didn't do anything more. And the reason for that is we had enough capacity, right? So the instance was large enough, so it can actually satisfy additional two pods. So let's make it more interesting, right? Let's say, I don't know, seven maybe. That should kind of trip it. So if we go here again, what you're going to see is Karpenter figured out, like, okay, I cannot fit those in, and as you can see here is we have six pending pods. They cannot be scheduled. So it only scheduled two of the pods in the first one, and the rest of this is still pending. So one proxy and the rest is just what we requested. And it started provisioning. So if you see here, it's already provisioned. This is just the timer that shows you the time since it's been provisioned. We have to wait until like 30, 40 seconds-ish, and the node should be ready to go. So yeah, it's ready. And as you can see, it's already pre-binded the pods. And they are not pending anymore, and they're kind of running now, which is great. So we ended up with 7 now, and that's kind of running. So let's crank that up a bit, right? Let's go with like, say, let's go with 200, right? Let's make it interesting. So let's see what happens to this end now. So as you can see, we are ending up with more and more pending pods. They're just kind of running up like crazy. Let's say this is a Black Friday thing, right? Like we have like big influx of customers. They're just being automatically scaled because we have to kind of ensure that everybody's served. And you have the bots waiting. And the Karpenter actually figures out, okay, we have additional 190 additional pods that need to schedule. And it kind of went on and computed that we need additional X amount of instances. Let's see, 2, 4, 6 additional instances that we need to provision. And it just added it in. As you can see, it's currently being provisioned. And it's going to be ready in a bit. And as soon as it becomes ready, all the pods are going to be automatically kind of scheduled and be running happily on those nodes. Okay, and as you can see, the number of pending pods are going down, and overall utilization, we actually ended up at 97%, which I think is a really fair number considering like what you can end up with like last autoscaler, right? So the utilization is really pushed to the max, and we're kind of utilizing the nodes all the way up, and you can trust me, if I would add more, it would just add more, and it would try always to balance it out. So what we can actually do is, let's say, Black Friday is over, our things are going down, but we're still kind of seeing a lot of traffic, so let's say we kind of reduce some of the pods, but we still need to kind of serve a little bit of traffic. And as you can see, the overall utilization went slightly down. I'm really sorry you can't read this, but neither could I. Oh, I can actually. It's 67%, you have to trust me on that. 87, pardon. So it's 87. So what I want to demonstrate here, if I manage to do it, fingers crossed, I've just opened logs just to kind of show you what's happening. It already happened. Sorry about that. I was too slow. But let's scroll up and see what happened actually. So what it actually figured out is that we actually have capacity which we can reschedule on other nodes, just fit it in other nodes and release some of the nodes kind of empty them down, right? So some of the nodes actually ended up empty. As you can see, it's using core learning, so it just core learned the node, which would automatically reschedule the pods in different nodes. And as those become empty, just deprovision them and remove them completely. So I actually ended up again with less of those, and we're still pretty good, right? We're like 94.6 utilization overall, which is a really good use. We can actually, I'm just trying to resort for that. It's really hard to get it right because it's so efficient. So I'm just gonna scale it down a little bit more, so it's gonna be slightly more interesting to see what happens now. So we're at 52. Let's see if I can catch it now. Yes, you're still there. So, yes, you're gonna see in a couple of seconds, hopefully. Here we go. So what it actually did, it said like, okay, I found there is an underutilized nodes, and I'm gonna do deprovisioning via the consolidation replace. So if you remember what I showed before, there are two types of consolidation. So deletion, which you should have seen before, but it was just too quick. And the second one is replacement. So the difference is the replacement would spin up new nodes, which you can see here, the new one is being spun up. It's provisioning a new one. It's C5 to X large. The reason why it's spinning that up is because it kind of simulated and said, I can spin up a new one, rebalance my workloads, and I'm gonna end up with optimal spread again. So how amazing is that? Nobody's impressed, okay. I was expecting a different response, but fine. Maybe it's just me. Right, the last thing before I wrap it up, what I wanted to show you is, I hope at least this is gonna look cool to you. So as you can see here, we have 4 instances running, super nicely utilized. all the workloads are running fine. And what I'm gonna do here is actually I'm gonna go and just do it live, hopefully it works. I'm gonna say edit deployment inflate. Now this is the deployment I deployed. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna look for the node selector that I specified in the deployment, which is AMD64. And as you can guess what I'm gonna do now, I'm just gonna say, I changed my mind. I don't want to run it on AMD anymore, I hate it. I really like AMD instances because I want to save some money. I'm just gonna say, fine, I'm happy with that. And let's see what happens here. What do you think is gonna happen? Because it doesn't match just anymore what I want, right? I want AMD, I want cool instances. And Karpenter immediately goes like, fine, deployment change. We want ARM instances now, so those are no good anymore. Let's spin up ARM instances. They can host 100 of our pods on ARM. It's gonna schedule them there, start putting in on it, and just deprovision the old stuff. Isn't that cool? Come on. Have to give me that. Thank you. You're a really tough crowd. Tough crowd to satisfy, but I guess, yeah. So let's just wait it out to see that, you know, I'm not kind of fooling around. It's actually doing that. So as you can see here, it's just adding more nodes because the reason why it's doing it gradually is how we define the deployment. So there is a rolling strategy defined, and it will always kind of try to ensure, I think, by default is 25% of the nodes needs to be running. So you just gradually migrate to new stuff. So yeah, right. Just not gonna wait this out because I know we're kind of running out of time, and I don't want to stand between you and the beer. I know there is one more left, so don't go. Just don't want to overrun for the next presentation. So I'm just gonna scale that down really quickly. I'm just gonna show you that that's gonna scale down, and it's gonna decommission the instances as soon as it figures out that they're empty. I think that the false RTL is actually 10 seconds, so it should be fairly quick. I'm not gonna wait for the whole thing, just to kind of show you it starts doing it. Come on, here we go. Right, that's it. Let me quickly return to I should have stayed at the slide where I was. It's gonna be really quickly, I promise. Here we go. The last thing, just to wrap it up very quickly. First of all, capacity planning is hard, so it's not an easy task to do, but luckily we have a tool such as Karpenter that can really help us with that, and it kind of tries to make it as simple as possible. As we all know, Kubernetes is never simple. So a couple of key takeaways. If you will take anything away from this presentation, except the demo that worked, is definitely kind of relying back to what we've seen with my story is it's definitely flexible, lowers the complexity, it's portable, it does support multiple providers, it's fast, as you can see, the latency is less than a minute to get a new instance. I think that's kind of really fascinating. And on the roadmap, they actually have a target to reach 15 seconds, which is quite fascinating. Then it's efficient, it knows how to do the scaling in different directions, so it knows how to scale up, scale down, scale in, scale out at the same time. It's very adaptive, so it always kind of tries to right-size it and picks up the instances that are cost-efficient. And it has the compliance built in with the TTL. Just a couple of things to keep in mind. Currently, support provider, as I said, is unfortunately AWS, but there is plans for adopting others in the future. Currently, it's not supporting the spot rebalance recommendations, but they're still working on that. Another heads up, be careful with non-interruptible workloads, obviously. So if you cannot afford the workload to be interrupted, maybe that's not the option for you. It's an open source project. Have a look at the issues open. Feel free to contribute. Full disclosure, I don't work for AWS. I just like the project. So it's an open source thing. Feel free to dive in. And that's it. Thank you. I'm on social media. I'm using Glimpse, I'm old school, still on Twitter, still trying to get a Mastodon, but yeah, feel free to reach out. Thank you. Oh. Thank you.